We've got a great talk planned for you tonight. I'd like to mention the Williamson County Master Gardeners Association. With grant monies that they've provided, we're able to do these lectures, and we try and do 3 a year. This is actually our 10th that we've done in the last 3 years. And Carol Reese, who's here tonight, this is her third, so she's our veteran. So we're excited about that.
I'm surprised y'all keep showing up. You know everything I say.
I'd also like to thank the Franklin Tree Commission. Ms. Brandy Blanton is here, and she's chair of the Tree Commission, and I'd like to thank them for their help in organizing these and getting them together. I am Todd Snackenberg, the city arborist. Thank you for reminding me. And I've been here about 5 years now, and very excited about this program that we've done through the Tree Commission. We've had some great speakers, and we tape everything, and it will be available on our website eventually. And it's a really good program. So at this time, I'll introduce Carol Reese, and she'll get started.
Oh, that's it? Okay.
Thought he might say something nice about me, but thank goodness he didn't. I don't have to live up to anything.
I'm going to call you a snake.
That's right. I was bitten by a snake this spring, and I've gotten so much attention from it that I'm arranging for another snake bite. So I'm gonna miss it when it's gone. A lot of you are familiar to me and familiar with me and know my philosophies on landscape design, so I'm probably preaching to the choir about some of this, but my title, Just Do It, was in hopes that if you haven't gotten around maybe to redoing your landscape, you might want to consider making it a little bit easier on yourself and a lot more fun. My vet did that, and talking about being bitten by the snake, he's the one I called first. He's my first line of medical defense, and he always makes my dog snake bites disappear within a day or two, and I still think I should have gone to him because I was in the hospital 3 nights. But he actually did that. He ripped out all of his shrubs against the house and called me one day and said, "Well, I've done it, you know, so come over and help me," because I do barter with him for veterinarian work in exchange for landscape help. So we did. We did his place, redid it, and it's been a lot of fun. So the clicker is what I don't have. Is this it? All right. Should be maybe self-explanatory. Let's see if it is. I know a lot of you are master gardeners, so I know you love plants. You like to collect plants, try out new plants, and that's sort of my style of landscape design too, because I really do like to have a design that allows you to experiment. And I've told this story to the landscape class before, but I always remember once when I had stopped to bring a plant. Some friends of mine had stopped and helped me when my car was broken down. I love their names. It was Rubel and Thule Asbull. That's their real names. Rubel and Thule stopped, and so I knew that Thule, y'all were wondering which one was the man, which one was the woman, weren't you? Thule was the woman. And she liked to feed her hummingbirds, so I bought her a butterfly bush to thank her, and when I went by, she said, "Well, I just had the yard landscaped. I don't know where I would put it." And sure enough, it was all holly, nandina, and boxwood. There was no place for a blooming shrub, and I said, "Would you not have liked to have a blooming shrub somewhere, Thule, or some flowers for your hummingbirds?" She said, "You know, I did. I would have liked that, but they didn't ask me, and I didn't think to ask them." And I thought, now, isn't that crazy, not to have a place to garden and have things that tell you what kind of season it is. By the way, if I fall down tonight, I've got on new shoes, and they're kind of tripping me up. They're a little big, and I put on thick socks, so if I'm a little clumsy, I haven't been drinking. I'm just extra clumsy because of my big new shoes. I'm not used to new shoes. So I just think it's funny that we don't think about these landscapes and try to imitate. Of course, most of us do try to imitate what goes on in nature. I met a guy who did landscape design once who thought he was the first person who'd ever thought of that. And I was like, I think that's been going on since the 1600s, dear. All right, so this is the opposite, right? This is somebody who likes plants, wants to experiment, and goes out and says, whole different philosophy of, I want to create something beautiful. I want to experiment with texture and color and design and shape and habit and try out new things mixed with old things. And that's part of the joy to me. I buy a lot of old dependables, and then I like to try something new. And it's just a lot of great fun. This, by the way, is Leanne Barron here in Nashville. A lot of you may know her from previous Master Gardener programs. And then you have people like this. And to me, this is about control. It's about by golly, I'm going to get this landscape beaten down, and it's going to do what I want it to do. And it is amazingly perfect. This guy is doing an awesome job, isn't he? It's scary, though. Can you imagine what would happen if one of those shrubs died? He would probably just lose it. And you know he's got to get out there and measure it with a yardstick. He's got to get it that perfect. And that lawn is absolute perfection. So if you came home with a perennial, where are you going to put it? How do you know what season of the year it is, except that the grass turns from green to brown, from green to brown, from green to brown? It's pretty sad to me. I had a boyfriend like this, and I know this is not a place I would want to live. You know, you couldn't leave a magazine on the coffee table if it was at the wrong angle. But instead, look at this, we get to experiment with color and pattern and different seasons and just so much wonderful texture there. So, to me, this is the kind of landscape I want. So we have to think about how we can accomplish this. And once you kind of look at this kind of mind and you start looking at landscapes as you drive around, you wonder why people do what they do. What is this guy? I mean, he don't want any plants. He didn't even want that zipper of hedge around the house. And those darn plants, they're living things, and they have detritus. They actually drop twigs and leaves and such. And my goodness, then they'd have to scrub the driveway more often. This house actually at one time had a Bradford pear. Of course, about the time it reached some stature, it was gone. What happened? Where are we? Okay. I guess I had a blank somewhere right there. I was supposed to have one more. This is kind of typical, isn't it? You drive around Jackson, the nicer suburbs up north of town, Jackson, Tennessee, and probably not so much here in Franklin. I think y'all may have a little bit more sophisticated taste in your landscapes. But a lot of times this is what you see. All the shrubs slammed against the house and pruned into abnormal forms. And the crepe myrtles butchered. And, you know, we can talk about meatballs and ding-dongs and pyramid and coneheads and all the things that people do to their shrubs. So my friend Jenny that I taught landscape design with down at Mississippi State defined landscape design as defining outdoor space with plants and hardscape for user needs, right? So you're actually choosing what you want from that landscape and saying, for my style, you know, for my dogs, for my children, or the fact that I like to cook or entertain, my landscape is going to suit me and my lifestyle. So you design that landscape to accommodate you, which is why I always resent seeing ads in magazines that say, send us a picture of your house and we'll design your landscape. How do they know what your tastes are or what it is that you want from that landscape? That's just impossible. They might could design you a foundation planting, but do you want one? We're going to consider that you might not even want a foundation planting. So how does this serve the people, the users? Does it? I think they serve it. I think they're a slave then to pruning their shrubbery. So that's what happens then. And why do we do this? I mean, this is sort of crazy. In the old days, our houses were built with wooden floors, right? House I grew up in down in Mississippi, big old country Victorian, had the pine floors, built in 1914. And it was up high off the ground on brick. If you're in East Tennessee or Middle Tennessee, it might have been on stone. You know, some places they put it on concrete pillars. So what you did a foundation planning to hide the fact that the house started 3 or 4 feet above the ground. Now it's a bad habit. We still do it. Even though a lot of times we shouldn't and don't need to, because then, you know, the shrubs didn't read the book. They didn't know they were supposed to stop at 3 feet. And they keep growing, and then you have to prune them, and just as constant pruning in order to keep you from being totally engulfed in shrubbery. So we have to think about, is this a good idea? I think if they had taken those shrubs and planted them out around the perimeter of the yard, they would have gotten some privacy, and there wouldn't be somebody taking a picture of their house to make fun of in a public forum. And I don't know about y'all, but when I'm home, I love people, I really do. I like getting out, I'm gregarious, I'm fun. But when I'm home, I like to be alone. I love my tattered nightgown. You know, I might want to go out and fill my hummingbird feeders without having to put real clothes on. Sometimes the dogs are doing something terribly embarrassing. You know, you don't know what they're going to run out the dog door with. You just have to be careful. So I really like my privacy. So I would, if I lived in town, I would have a perimeter planting. I would need that privacy and that screening. Now, that's not true of everybody, I know, but that's true of me. When you start driving around looking at what people do to their shrubbery, you start kind of wondering. You make up stories in your head about what happened and why. These have a voluptuous feel to them. I think there's a nice, but I suspect there were more of them at one point, don't you? And then they got killed, probably from weed eater damage or different things. But there's mostly, I see that these are missing. Then we've got the people who like trains. The train's going that way. It's pulling two cars. And these also could be meth lab people because they don't want you to see in. And there is nothing that indicates how to get into the house. Actually, the door is right there to the right, right behind the engine. But you can't tell. They don't really want to help you into that house. So you're pretty much they're making sure that you don't know how to get in. Then there's just sad things, just pitiful, pitiful. Why do people do this to their shrubbery? I said, you know, I'm one who picks up stray dogs. If it were a little puppy, I would take it home and fatten it up and stop torturing it. It would be plumped up and fine and healthy in short order. So this one's not that terrible, but still, let's look at it and see if it makes any sense. The shrubs are getting too tall. They're going to have to keep pruning them. What if one of those in the front dies? Where are you going to find a replacement? You know, those are actually some kind of holly, but if it were boxwood, you know, when I worked at a garden center all through graduate school, and somebody came in one time and said, a UPS truck backed over my boxwood, need to replace it. I said, okay, is it a common box? Is it a Japanese little leaf box? Is it a Korean box? I don't know. I said, well, does it smell like cat urine? Yes, it does. Okay, then it's common box, but is it Safruta Cosa or is it Varger Valley or, you know, which one? Well, of course, they didn't know. So you have to consider sometimes things have to be replaced, and if you're doing a symmetrical formal design and something dies, you're pretty much up a creek. Unless you got lots of money and you kind of keep the replacements back there in the maintenance area, you know, and they do that at the big formal gardens. They really do. So, but here, I would keep the Japanese maple. I love to see some small trees limbed up near the windows. Actually, I keep talking about my vet. My vet and his wife are very good friends of mine, and they have a blood good Japanese maple limbed up around the window in their bathroom, the guest bathroom that I use when I'm over there. And I love going in there and using the bathroom because the sunlight filters through those pretty red leaves. And you can see out, but you feel concealed from the street, and it's a beautiful thing to do is to limb small trees up above the windows so that you can actually see through it. But the rest of it, I think, needs to go. I love the lusterleaf holly at each corner. It's one of my favorite hollies, but that's not the right place for it. They're going to end up being 15, 20 feet tall and wide. They should be part of the screen, you know, for that privacy. So this is something they need to consider. Now, I don't mean to imply that I almost said a double negative. Some houses do need a foundation planting, right? Some do. This one does. So, but I think every house should be evaluated to see if they do. This is the guy who was scrubbing his driveway. There's that poor Bradford pear that's gone now. And I think this house needs one. But did he put the pear on the right side? I mean, if you were trying to balance that house and the slope of that hill, it's on the wrong side. I think a mass planting of some nice spiky shrubbery would have been great over on the left-hand side, and then peter down until you got over to the garage, and then maybe a small limbed-up tree, kind of an asymmetrical balance. That's much more forgiving. Then if something does die, you're not ruined. You can replace it without having to go out and find exactly the right shrub with exactly the right size. Now, some people really like to have people come in their garden. It's just whole different philosophies about it. This is actually Lucy Hardiman, and I'd mentioned that I like my privacy, and when I'm home, I don't necessarily want people dropping in. However, Lucy does, so I just want to appreciate the fact that people have different philosophies about what guides their landscape choices. She has little signs that say, welcome to my garden, and, you know, come on in and stroll down, have a seat. But, of course, she's a garden designer. She also wants the work. So that's not my style, but some people absolutely do that. I mean, I think you can have both. I think you can be attractive from the street and have your privacy. And I think this accomplishes both goals. And one thing I like about this picture is that it has some structure. And I do like to have some structure. I may sound like I like things all wild and woolly and mixed up, and I do to a certain extent, but you need a certain amount of structure to balance out the wild. I was speaking at Longwood, actually, a couple of years ago, and there were a couple of garden designers, and we were having lunch, and they were totally opposite of that. When they finished a landscape, it was completely natural, all natives, looked like the hand of man had never been there. I love the wild. I go out every day with the dogs and ramble through the wild areas. But isn't there something kind of fun and comforting about seeing the hand of human beings? And I think there's something comforting to the human psyche to see that the hand of man has been there. And I don't know about y'all. Do y'all play these crazy games in your head like, should I crash in the wilderness? Blah, 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 blah. So if I'm crashed in the wilderness and I'm trying to find my way back to civilization, well, the first time I see a bit of fence, you know, or the edge of a corner of a house, I'm going to go, man, my kind, I'm found. So I think there is something in the human psyche that responds to that. Plus, it just gives you a bit of a focal point, and it makes the landscape look disciplined if you have a little bit of structure and you can play off of that structure. I'm also a big fan of natural colors. I'm not a fan of white in the landscape because it shows every speck of dirt. I have designed my entire house and landscape based on the colors of dirt and dog hair. Works for me. So, but I think this is a good thing. It's beautiful from the street, yet the people have total privacy. Now, if you do need a foundation planting, it doesn't have to be the meatballs and the cones and the ding-dongs. It can be very naturalistic. This is, again, I love Leanne's house in Nashville. Leanne, by the way, did have the formal trimmed boxwoods before she started taking the Master Gardener classes, and she's totally revamped it. So have y'all been to her house? She's often on some of the garden tours now. She's over on Linden, if you want to drive by. Her sourwood is glorious right now. But anyway, she's softened it up in his alley. She's kept a little bit of formality, which again, I think is a good idea, a little bit of formality. How many of you been out to Gumtree Farms, Susan Feltz, out at Hermitage, Tennessee? Gumtree Farms is a wonderful nursery. It's no longer actually no longer active now. And Susan is a potter and an artist. But I like this landscape because her house actually sits on a hill that slopes steeply away, and this makes the house look anchored, like it's not going to fall down the hill or slide down the hill. And she's got some seclusion there, yet she can see out just fine. A lot of people think, well, I don't want those things close to the house because I can't see through them. Sure you can. And then we'll go back to that human psyche thing. You know, the human beings want to be hidden in the edge of the woods looking out to make sure the saber-toothed tiger isn't creeping up on them. So you actually do want to look out through and out into the open, and it makes you feel more comfortable. A little bit secluded, a little bit covered up. So I think that's a great way to go. And also, foundation planting should perhaps be more generous than people normally leave room for. Unfortunately, it's not usually the homeowner who decides that. It's the developer, right? They leave that little narrow strip between the sidewalk and the house, and you have to figure what kind of plant could possibly go in that narrow strip. Whereas this is my friend Jimmy Williams, and he designed his sidewalks to go around his house, and they are also the border for his beds. So that's pretty smart, because what do? When you're out in your yard, you walk around and examine your flowers, and you come home from work and you examine them again. You get up in the morning and you look at them again, and sometimes things have actually changed overnight. So it's a real smart way to go, and then it allows you a lot more room to put things and experiment in different seasons. Doesn't have to be that narrow row of typical plants. So a generous foundation planting, a generous area for the foundation planting. I went totally different. My house, and this is not my house, this is what inspired what I did. I didn't really want any shrubbery next to my house. And the reason I'm not showing you my house is I just moved in last fall, and it's not planted yet, it's not developed yet, and it's still got the new house syndrome, which means where I could not afford sod, there's now weeds, and I even put down turnip greens. And then the soil caved in around the septic tank, and you know all that new stuff that goes on. The water still hasn't decided exactly where it wants to go everywhere. But I did. I put gravel all the way around my house and contained it with edging, because my house is sort of like a pole barn. and I wanted the water to be able to fall into that gravel and move away from the house in a gradual slope. And my patios on the front of the house are actually gravel as well. And so the water filters through that gravel before it hits the hill. It slows it down so I don't have the soil rushing away. I learned a lot about gravel doing that house, by the way. You know, all the numbers mean sizes. And the bigger the number, the smaller the gravel. And number 10 is very fine and wonderful, but you cannot use it on a slope because it'll wash away just as badly as sand. So you go up to about a 7 or an 8, it'll not wash as badly. And if you have a really steep slope, you need to go up to a smaller number. So it's all this fun stuff about learning the gravel. I could not afford the beautiful, smooth river stones, but maybe one day I'll get to that point. But I like the look of it. It's clean, and I'm going to have limbed up Japanese maples. I have an extensive Japanese maple collection. I'm embarrassed. I counted. I have 29 Japanese maples. And I want to do some kind of alleys around the house and make a shady ambiance because the property I bought had been logged over, so it was so gnarly with brambles and saplings that I basically had to clear the whole little ridge where I perched the house. And so I'm just naked. I have never lived in a house with no shade. I was terrified all summer that my electricity would go off and we'd just die there. The dogs and I would just scuttle away like leaves, you know. Luckily, there's a creek on the property, so we could at least maybe go down there and lie in the cold water till the electricity. And I made the electric people mad when I built the house, so I'll be the last one to get fixed. Sure that when the electricity goes off, so didn't mean to do that. Anyway, I think this is a great look, and this is actually kind of an oriental style. This is the Japanese house at Chapel Hill, but I think it's great, and gravel can be quite attractive. We've seen gravel used badly, right? White rock and red lava rock, we can kind of rule that stuff out. And again, anything white jars my eye. I don't want to do white. But I think this is a great way to go, and it does keep the water from going under the house and keeps the water moving away from the house and in the directions that you want. Now, I talked about limbing things up and looking through them, and this also does a couple of things besides the idea that it makes you feel secure, makes the human psyche feel like you're able to hide and look out. But it also is more comfortable on the eye. And I noticed this one beautiful, it was a day like today, beautiful fall day, and the light was gorgeous and the woods were turning. And I stepped out into the sunlight. This was when I lived over south of Lexington to enjoy it better. And everything kind of went white. It kind of got bleak. And I thought, what? And I stepped back into the shade. And I realized that when I'm standing in the shade, my eyes would open fully. My pupils were shutting down when I stepped out into the light. So actually, when you look through shade out into light, you more fully appreciate color. You're actually able to receive it better. It's a physical aspect of the eye that allows you to see better. So it's a wonderful thing to do, is to frame things up and look through them. Framing is a great way to go. All right, we talked a little bit then about my philosophy about landscape design. For me, is I'm, you know, a little concerned about what people see from the street, but not so much. That sounds selfish, doesn't it? I really don't care what they see. It's what I see. So the view from my kitchen sink, and that's what my house was all about, that same house where I appreciated the fall light, the way that the sun angled across that kitchen sink, the window, I thought, when I build my house, I'm going to copy this. Because the sun set over to the west, southwest of that window. So late in the evening, it would angle across that porch. It wasn't directly in my eyes, but it backlit all the pots on my porch. So my cannas, my coleus, everything would glow like translucent. It was like stained glass. And it was this magic hour, you know. It was like, oh, love this light this time of day. When I build my house, I'm going to do this. Also down at my house in Mississippi, where my niece lives now, my sister had first redone that house. And it was originally an old tenant cabin that had no plumbing. And so when they put the bathroom in it, she designed a window right in front of the John. And so I thought, I love this. And every bathroom in my house has a window in front of the John. By the way, I built my house for living with dogs. A lot of you all know I'm the crazy dog lady. And the builders I found, they were just a kind of a country family. It was a daddy and a son, and the daddy had learned from his daddy, and a crew of five that had been together for decades, you know, and they were just good old country guys. I really liked them. And they kind of thought this was weird that I had a dog mudroom. They called it the dog's bathroom. I mean, I did put a commode in there, but I mean, why not? Because it was right next to the kitchen, and it would be convenient for me to use the commode. But it was really for washing the dogs off, should they come in the house bloody or muddy. You know how the dogs, you never know. So you can come right from the deck into the dog mud room, have a big 5-foot shower with a handheld thing for the big dogs, and I have a laundry sink for the little dogs, and we can get cleaned up. Sometimes I'm dirty too before we go in the house. So, and so every room had a window in all three of my bathrooms. Three is overkill for one person, I realize, but the dog's bathroom. By the way, when I was doing the house, and I said, have y'all ever done, like I did a rebar railing on the deck? I said, Tommy, have y'all ever made a rebar railing for decks? And he said, no, we ain't never built a house like yours. He said, but there ain't nothing we can't build. So I really love those guys. They really enjoyed working on the house. I said, I should have put some pictures in, because I actually am proud of how it turned out. It just needs to be fixed up a little bit more. You start running out of money toward the end, right? But it's, somebody said, describe it. I said, it's if Frank Lloyd Wright built a pole barn for dogs. Sort of modern, sort of rustic, and very comfortable for my lifestyle. But anyway, what do you see when you look out the window? That's what I'm all about. And I've been saying I'm going to do this, and now I'm in my house, and I'm going to do it. I'm going to do a four-season garden to be viewed from the commode. Once it gets established, I'm going to take a picture of it every day, and I will do a program on the view from my commode throughout the year. Seriously, I'm planning on doing this. So, actually, I met with an architect after I had designed the house, and he high-fived me. He said, girl, you don't need me. So I thought, oh, I feel so good about that. That's great. So the view, what do you see when you look out? And I love a little bit of a structural element in that view. You need some structure so you can be wild and crazy with your plants. You've heard those stupid rules, haven't you? You can't plant in onesies. You have to have drifts. That's bull. That's malarkey. But you can do all the onesies you want if you have a little structure in the landscape. See, this is all onesies. It looks very disciplined, doesn't it? Because we've got the urn, because we've got the overhead structure, this is at Jimmy's. And he does have some unifying elements, like most of the things in here are silvery or white, is another one. The view from Jimmy's deck, you look down, you're looking toward the back, you've got some structural elements with the fencing, you're tempted to go out there and explore in the landscape. We've got plenty of onesies going on here, but it's a very well-designed landscape. And I think the lawn also plays a role in that. I'm not anti-lawn. A lot of people will say lawn reduces maintenance. I mean, reducing lawn reduces maintenance. That's really not true. They have done trials where the lowest maintenance is actually just running a lawnmower over your lawn once a week. You know, when we have flower beds, we get out and we plant, we weed, we mulch, we prune, we fret over the insects and, you know, all that kind of stuff. So actually, you know, I like a balance of both. And people that say that lawns aren't wildlife friendly apparently have never seen robins. Robins love lawns. Phoebes love lawns. Bluebirds love lawns. So I think a mix is great. And if you have dogs, you need lawns. If you have children, you need lawns. A little bit of water in the landscape, a little bit of structure. What do you see when you look out? And you're in charge of that view. You're the artist in charge of that view. If you don't want to see something, you can screen it out with plants or structure. And if you don't see anything pleasurable, create something. You're going to paint with your plants, with your hardscape. You're going to create something that gives you pleasure through the year. And I always tell people that's where to start. They kind of feel overwhelmed. Where do you start? And I did too, you know. I remember in the beginning when I first started trying to do things with my landscape, I'd climb up on my roof and study it, and I would kept rejecting different ideas until I finally get frustrated and go in the house and watch Home and Garden television, you know. So that goes back to that just do it. Because just do something, because a lot of the ideas that I made me change my mind, I remember thinking, well, maybe that should be a border there, a shrub border, but if I ever get a horse again, that might be where I should have the horse shed. I'm never going to get a horse again. At this age, come on, who are we kidding? You break the hips and it's all over, you know? And even if I did, I can change it, right? We change the house, we knock down walls, we add windows, we change the carpet, we can change it. But they scared us. When we first started learning landscape design, they made you feel like you had this plan on paper, and it was commitment. And when you got it right, you got it right the first time, then it was going to be perfect from then on out. Then that's just not true. Things die, things change, things become shady. It's a dynamic art form that we work with over time. And some of those changes are wonderful, and isn't change good, really? That's why we get bored with silk flowers, because they look the same all the time. So part of the joy is watching it change through the years and working with that change and letting nature dictate some of that. Why are hay bales so fascinating when we're driving down country roads? They catch our eye, the shadows. And I'm convinced it's because we're looking at this natural sprawl, kind of unpredictable, and all of a sudden there's this formal structure thrown out there in the center. And there's our human side again. We're going, oh, something formal is thrown out there. And it's very arresting, and we like that. So if we imitate that in our landscapes, then we can be as wild as we want around our formal structures, and it'll still look very disciplined in landscape. So it allows us to experiment and yet look collected. I'm doing a talk down in Louisiana that's called Being a Plant Collector and Still Looking Collected. And this is kind of, you know, what you need, a little bit of formality in there so you can get away with it. So here, a whiskey barrel kicked apart provides a formal element. Yet if you study this landscape, it's a big old wild thicket. That's what it is, which is good. If you love your birds, you want some thicket. You want some brown thrashers love to nest on the ground below low shrubbery, one of my favorite native birds. So you want some thicket, but you don't want it to look thickety. So golly, a whiskey barrel kicked apart is a pretty cheap sculpture, isn't it? Just an empty pot. Oh, shoot, who's the poem? A Jar in Tennessee. Do y'all know that poem? It's, I should have printed it out and put it on your handout. Basically, it's if you set a jar in the wilderness surrounds the jar, which is true. See, you know, we love to cram things in our pots, too, but actually just setting an empty pot out there will do the same as that hay bale. Another shot of it, just an empty jar will do so much. Oh, sorry, got a little... moved a little slower. Faye Beck, my friend Faye Beck in Oak Ridge, does such a beautiful job with that. She's got a great hand with her landscape. She's a tremendous plant collector. She's out west right now with my colleague Jason Reeves buying plants, and no telling what she'll come home with. But she has so many different plants, but she creates these little vignettes so that usually you're only seeing a particular collection at a time with some structural element, some focal point. If we get too carried away with that, it gets cluttered again, doesn't it? We don't want to turn around and see a whole bunch of different structures at once. We want to kind of frame it where we have about just, you know, one in the major view at a time. You know, I was thinking about how similar any kind of good design is to music. You know, if you think about boring, repetitive music, it'll drive you crazy very quickly. And too much competition, for example, you've heard jazz, where everybody's trying to play lead at the same time and it just becomes a cacophony. But if some people will play background while they let the other take the lead, whether it's bluegrass or jazz, whatever your favorite genre, then it's beautiful. Some improvisation against some symmetrical background. And I think, you know, we have to think about those very things when we design our landscape. So just a beautiful pot anchors this beautiful landscape at Faye Beck's. Faye's just got such a great eye for finding great pots too. Y'all know this is supposed to be my pot. She had come to a talk I did one year when I was into a fad of collecting black plants. And I was all about black foliage, and I was trying to find me some yellow pots. Really go gaudy, you know, on it. And next time I visited Faye, she said, I remembered your talk about the yellow pots, and I found the most beautiful yellow pot. And I thought the next words would be, and I bought it for you. And she's heard me tell this story, so she knows that I still think that should be my pot. She just laughs. She calls it Carol's yellow pot that's not leaving my premises. So anyway, but I love that pot. She has a great eye for putting pots and even gazing balls. And, of course, gazing balls can be used badly, but I think she's got not only how she places them, but she often pairs them with plants that will repeat that color. So that's a beautiful look. And just the way she puts her hypertufa in her landscape arranged here and there gives you that little bit of a structural element to play off with her big plant collection, her wild onesies everywhere. Furniture can be that way too. I love an Adirondack chair with a
pretty paint job. You know, it's kind of, this is kind of special. And although I'm not really good at doing freehand art, I could probably fake this by simply tacking some Virginia creeper leaves on the chair and spray painting over them. Paint the base coat would be the color of the leaves, and then whatever foliage you want. And I actually did that to some of my pots this year using sumac leaves and made it look like they're kind of flickering with shadows and stuff. So fun to do, just kind of playing around with different structural elements, but at the same time adding a little touch of whimsy to those. I love rusted metal towers, and this is a great look, just again to add some of that to your landscape. Or if you like a little more formal element, a water feature, with of course the water is also a great way to go. Another good look with gazing ball, to me this is a beautiful look because I love the contrast there, that blue gazing ball against that. That's a great plant, by the way. Do any of y'all have that? That's the Spirea thunbergii ogon. You know the old Thunberg Spirea. You grew up with it. You had it, or somebody down the street had it. That little fine wispy leaf Spirea blooms very early in the spring. Then you get the wispy foliage, and then it will get a little fall color. And this one has all of those elements, but it also has the gold foliage through the summer. By the way, you can buy it under the name Ogon, which means golden, and you'll find lots of plants called Ogon. You'll find an Ogon Don Redwood. You'll find an Ogon Sweet Flag. That just means golden. But this plant is also sold under the name Mellow Yellow. I think they decided old hippies would buy it better if they gave it a better name. But either way, it's a great plant, and again, it's one of those that will outlive you. It's just terrific. Look at how the little bit of structure works here. All the different shapes. I love this landscape. I could just look at that for a long time and not be tired of it. Look at the different textures. And it's funny how I make fun of meatballs when they're trimmed purposefully, but when they're a natural meatball, I think they're really cool. And I actually do have a thing for conifers, and some of the conifers that'll have a naturally strong form, I think, can play that element in the landscape. You don't even have to have a piece of structure if you find a very formally shaped plant material. So again, the same here, the urn. I saw somebody just actually stack store-bought pavers like this to use as an entrance to their garden, and it was a good look. And I thought, well, that's a quick fix right there. This is at UT Knoxville. How many of y'all have been to the gardens in Knoxville? You ought to go sometime. It's really nice, and it's just really coming along over the years. And this was an herb garden, but I love spirals. I think this is really a wonderful element. So on the larger landscape, certainly to build something like this, I imagine you would need to plant something that really liked it dry, because that's going to be difficult to keep watered unless you install some kind of piping or tubing. A plant itself can be the formal element if it has its own naturally formal shape. And I know y'all heard me push these yuccas. I love the color guard yucca. To me, it's like putting a bow on the package. That is the focal point. And again, if you yank that plant out of that landscape, all of a sudden you realize it's pretty messy. This is one of Tom Pellis' designs in Memphis. And that yucca, you know, if you said, Carol, you've got to have 10 plants in your landscape, well, that's one I know I'm going to have. I love color guard yucca because it looks good winter and summer. It's low maintenance. You can use it in so many ways. You can use it in containers or in the ground. It's so just a terrific plant. It's actually native. This is a variegated form of our yucca filamentosa. This one is called Margaritaville. And Margaritaville will make a trunk. One of the great things about color guard, that's as tall as it ever gets because it never makes a trunk. So the filamentosas, they'll make new pups, but they never make a trunk. And a lot of times it's the trunk-forming ones that people get upset with because they get tall and lanky and you got the dead leaves hanging down from underneath and they kind of don't know what to do with them. But the filamentosas never make a trunk, so they actually reach a predictable height. I mean, how many plants can you name that get yay high and stop? Not many. Now, this is a recurvifolia, so it will make a trunk. But I love the long recurving leaves from the trunk, so it actually is going to get very, very sculptural. This one is a little hard to find, I'll confess to you. Jason, my colleague at work, had fallen in love with this particular plant we had seen somewhere, and he put out word that he would pay $40 for a 1 gallon if anybody, any friend could find it. And that's, for Jason, he's frugal. It was a lot of money. I walked into Lowe's in Jackson and found 7 of them in 3 gallon pots for $21.95. So I bought all 7.
And on my way to the checkout counter, a lady said, "Those are gorgeous. Where did you find those?" I said, "Ma'am, I got them all. But I hadn't paid for them yet. I'll let you have one." And I should have never told Jason that. He was so furious. He was like, "Who was she to get a Margaritaville yucca?" I was like, "Sorry." I mean, they're actually, once you have them, they make pups you can break off. We've got more than these now. They are hard to find. They're fabulous. All right, talking about strong sculptural plants can play that role. The group spire. I love these narrow columnar plants. Fastigiated is the fancier word for them, but tall columnar plants do that strong vertical line in the landscape. I get a little bit upset. I don't know. I read people talk about narrow plants. And they're great for streets, and they're great for narrow applications between houses. Well, yeah, but what about just for design? Sometimes you just want, I mean, I promise you, if you buy a columnar plant and plop it out there, all of a sudden you start thinking, huh, wouldn't some spiky things look good next to that? And, you know, wouldn't some moundy things look good next to that? It's sort of like this the beginning of beginning to play with form. So it's not just for places where you need a narrow plant. It's for just the strong vertical element and having fun with that. You can force plants that aren't naturally symmetrical or formal into those. And even though I've preached earlier about not wanting to prune things a lot, when you want to prune something a special way for a particular design intention, absolutely have at it. So look at this. This is our old Rose of Sharon. Normally kind of a rangy, lanky thing. So what they've done is limbed it up and then gave it a nice little buzz cut. And of course, Rose of Sharon blooms on the new wood. So that makes it force out new wood and gives you lots more flowers. And look at how beautiful that gives you a little bit of a formal element in this big rambling border. This is up at Into Crumboats in Fox Hollow, and I thought, one day I'll do that. A guy down in McMinnville told me, he said, "Girl, you told us about doing that to them old Rose of Sharon's, and after I did it to all the ones at the nursery, they flew out the door." I said, "All right, I like helping people sell plants." Another, this is Dan Hinckley's. This is the real Heronswood before Burpee bought it and moved it. But the play of natural form against some sculptural form. And look at the lime there. I'm sorry, but that's beautiful. I'm not anti-lime. I don't worry about making it perfect, but I do love a smooth, velvety space. When I put down that zoysia sod last fall, I actually bought zoysia sod, and I'm not a turf person normally, but when you've got scraped, bare, red soil and winter's coming, you need to put something down. The dogs thought it was Christmas. I mean, they were sure that was for them. I had no idea how much dogs loved zoysia sod. They laid on it and scratched their backs. They pooped on it. They did all kinds of terrible things to it. It was just joy to them. Now that I've said that, though, this landscape has absolutely no turf. And sometimes that makes sense. This is a beautiful wooded lot in Collierville. They did not own a lawnmower. They had no lawnmower. And that just sounds delightful sometimes, doesn't it? So imagine on a hot day, they're driving home, everybody's out mowing their yard and all that droning going on. They pull in their cool, shady driveway and shut it off and walk in. So kind of neat. That's actually the street out front, so they have made it a livable landscape space even out in the front of the house. Moss is a great thing to do, too, if you do have a shady landscape. The moss is a beautiful evergreen ground cover. And this is moss, and in the foreground is not grass. That is the little dwarf golden sweet flag. So a lot of times people, I still can't believe people are doing this. Most people have kind of gotten over it. But I still think people are obsessed with forcing grass to grow where it does not want to grow. You have a shady, mossy landscape, then go with the moss. Moss and fern and dwarf sweet flag or upright sweet flag and some evergreen fern like autumn fern and some beautiful shrubbery. And look at that mossy ground cover. It's just fabulous. This is at Gardens Oy Vey, and Sadie's gone on to cross the Rainbow Bridge now, but she loved her mossy landscape. So it's a great way to go. I had to show off my dog once I showed Sadie. Now, how do you get a purple Jack Russell Terrier? Well, they're always, if you have a, if you've ever had a Jack Russell, they're always into something. And she managed to roll in the poke salad. The pokeberries had gotten knocked down, and she managed to get all in there after rabbits and rats. And she's very proud of herself, as you can tell. So, another thing we read, you know, that you needed to plant in masses, big sweeps. Isn't that boring? This is Dwarf Yopine. This is right in front of the office where I work. Now those are gone. We've ripped it out. We've gone with a lot more interesting plantings. But it's just like, oh, come on now. Can you put something in there, some different texture? Both are great plants. Bar Harbor Nandina and the Dwarf Yopon are great plants. But I don't want to look at that more than I have to. We're tired of looking at it, aren't we? Ah, isn't that better? This is Jimmy's. Look at Jimmy's. One of these. One. Okay, he does have three hostas in a row. I'll give you that. But the wonderful mixtures of things, all about foliage color, different heights, different canopies. Look at the formal element. We got that little bit of an urn and stack sitting there as well. Even on a smaller scale, we could have lots of onesies. This is at phase again. Love the thyme, the loons there nestled in the thyme. So even if you have a smaller landscape, the same principles will still apply. At Inta's, Inta Krumboldt's is her big plant collection. And here's where I see that the lawn does play that formal element for you. And a lot of people are kind of confused about where to start. And I think that the turf, should the turf be your floor, think of it as water. Let it move around your landscape like a flow. It could be a pool or it could be a stream that moves around your landscape. And your beds take place along that water. So that's a place to start to me is walk around your landscape and think. And if y'all are gardeners, you know you fill up beds faster than you think, don't you? You can't have too big of beds, I don't think. But if you shape beautiful forms and create beautiful bed shapes, it'll look landscaped even before you start putting the plants in. So great way to go and let that turf just move you, lead you around that property. Here we see the path this flows. It's about the line, really. If you stand in front of a canvas, the first thing you do is sort of sketch out the forms, right? This part of the canvas is going to be devoted to this and the other part to that. So, and there's, tell me that gravel path is unattractive. That is absolutely stunning. It can be a beautiful, beautiful element. I like crushed gravel because it will pack down hard over time, whereas pea gravel continually moves around and gets in your sandals. Line. This is just, looks so landscaped, but it's just about the line. The line that's created there between the turf and the ground cover. It could just be mulch. I'm not a fan of steel edging. It always comes up out of the ground. Plastic's even worse. I just would use my shovel and cut down and make that V trench to catch and contain the mulch or the ground cover. But that's all about the line, is all that it's about right there. Here, this is about line really too on a smaller scale. The line created by the walk, the little bit of mondo grass that encircles that bit of patio. So line, the first thing to do is draw those lines on your landscape. Another example, I love spirals as I mentioned, and this beautiful water feature just bubbles over those stone, and then the stone just spirals out and out and out into that woodland. Beautiful look. Look at this line. I think this is such a smart, smart landscape. And I still don't even remember what city I was in. I just remember I had to pull over and take this picture. I think I was in Charleston. That curve leads you right in and up that front step. This was actually one of those old subdivisions that has the big houses that sit up and that real steep bank drops down to the sidewalk. So what they had done was actually cut into that bank and made parking. Because most of the time, you know, you got to drive up that narrow, you've seen those houses, you got the concrete wall on either side and you have to squeak your car up there. And for visitors, there's really no place to park except out on the street. But they cut into the bank and made visitor parking. Then the visitors actually walked to the front door, which is a lot of times visitors are not led to the proper door. But the smartest part in the whole landscape to me was that opening that leads you to the front door was not square to the street. It was set at an oblique angle. So if you're standing in the doorway in your nightgown and people can't look right into your house, it's giving you a little bit of a screening because of that oblique angle. Another great thing is that, I was afraid of that. I was hoping I was finding the, yeah, there we go. The screen. Look at that nice screen between the houses next door. So this is very, very well done. The lines don't have to be curving. These are obviously square, straight lines, but it serves the same purpose because look at that mayhem of plant material. This is up at Joe Eck and Wayne Winterodes in Vermont, but very structured terraced landscape, and then their enormous crazy plant collection surrounding it. So great way to go. Even just a mowed path adds discipline. I love just a straight path mowed through just to keep the chiggers off of you, and so you can see the copperhead snakes. But doesn't that lead you on? It's just a wonderful, wonderful look to it. So just that line. So the first thing you should do is think about the lines on your landscape and decide where they're going to go and where they're going to lead you. It can be just store-bought material and still look quite wonderful. This guy was 83. This is several years ago, so he's probably getting close to 90 now. But he did a little different stuff with, you know, your typical store-bought pavers from the big box stores, made a little bit of a curve there, and that great cat got into every picture. Like, oh, wait. Okay, now I got the picture. Great pose. Starting to rain, as you can see in this picture, too. Launch makes a good path. This great line leads you across Joeck and Wayne Winter Roads. And a very interesting little piece of paving that I'm crazy about at Cheekwood. It's got that element I talk about all the time, that it's got a geometric form, the rectangle, but the irregular ramble through it. So basically, you could accomplish this by choosing the right blocks to make your corners and your edges, and then whatever's left, you choose the irregular stone to ramble through. Much more interesting than if it were all square, and much more interesting than if it were all irregular. I've shown that. Overhead elements are pretty easy to do, really. The digging the hole to hold your poles is the worst part of it. Then whatever pattern you want to come up with overhead. This is actually Susan Felt's vegetable garden. And I made the mistake of calling that her scarecrow, not knowing that was a plaster cast of her face. She corrected me. I was at a talk one time, she said, I love it, she dresses it differently for every season. She came up and said, I like to call her the garden goddess, if that's okay with you. And I said, okay, for now on it is the garden goddess, Susan. Now, a lot of her stuff is not meant to be permanent. We talked about the fact that gardens change over time, could and should, and this is simply saplings there out of her own woodland. Well, she got in it, a few nails and a little concrete, so whenever it falls to the ground, come up with a new design, a new pattern. And it's also where it makes sense. You don't go out and just build a structure in the middle of the yard. This transitions from her lawn out into her woodland garden. So you want to put your arbors where they will make sense, where people actually are transitioning from one area to the next. I love this. I'm dying to do this look. That is one of the, you know, conifers that actually does well in the heat of the south. That's the weeping blue Atlas cedar. So here we got a combination of a little bit of structure and a little bit of naturalistic form. They're slow. That's their one fault. I wondered how it would work with weeping yaupon. That'd be faster and cheaper. The weeping blue Atlas cedar, I guess buy the biggest one you can and train it over that area. And now they have that wonderful new weeping Japanese maple called ryusen. Have you seen that one? It's a big snaky looking weeping thing. It's supposed to grow real fast. I've got three, so I may try it with my ryusen Japanese maples. I love this. This is so cool. Go around the country and see the things that people come up with for overhead structures. That element we really love to go through and into another part of the garden. Or just, I talked about using alleys. I want to do a lot of little alleys around my landscape. That's my brother Barrett and his wife Anita. It was in the Dallas Arboretum. It was 105 degrees that day. You think that didn't feel good? A lot of people think about doing it with big trees. I don't know how much time y'all have left. I don't have that much time. Or that scale of landscape, but I can certainly do it with, and choose something durable. You sure don't want to do it with an ornamental cherry that's going to succumb to fungal canker or borer. But lilac chase tree is an old heirloom shrub that has no problems or pests, and it's going to be there probably after you're long gone. And it's kind of got a gnarly look to it. I really like it. Some people who like their plants neat and symmetrical may not. Or the overhead structure can certainly be the saplings off your place, like Joe and Wayne did at their place up in Vermont. And while I'm there, I have to show you their beautiful vegetable garden. During the long Vermont winter, they would sit in front of the fire and read through their vegetable catalogs and flower catalogs. And as they finished each one, they would rip the pages out. Then they would line the paths with their pages and then put the straw over it, and the pages of the catalogs are actually composting into the garden. Surely that's extra good compost, wouldn't you think? Isn't that beautiful? My gosh, I've never seen, our gardens don't look like that down in Mississippi where I'm from. I think that is stunning. Overhead structure down at Felder's, made out of rusted metal, a beautiful look, kind of crazy. Of course, Felder likes his stuff on the wild side. And then he did this wonderful thing which is actually a green roof. And that is made of some, he did hire somebody to put in the steel pilings that hold it up, but the rest of it is marine plywood and flashing that you buy at the big box stores. And then up at the top, you can see he's planted common variegated monkey grass because he likes to celebrate the plants that everybody else makes fun of. That look again, the alley. Looking through things, I kind of wasted this spider web for years because I put it against a wall. And then I was somewhere at a sculpture garden where you looked through a sculpture out into the garden, and it dawned on me, that's going to be much better hung on the edge of my deck. And once I hung it out there, it was perfect. I bought that big spider web, by the way, down at West Point, Mississippi, at the Prairie Arts Festival. There's a guy down there who does chairs out of them, too. He does spider web chairs and spider web tables, some really cool stuff. And then I found the spider out in Portland, Oregon. I had to carry it home on my lap on the plane, but that's all right. People gave me bad looks, but I didn't care. There, we're having more fun than this guy, this poor guy. I keep imagining there's one woman who lives in that house and he lets her buy one plant. It was the Bradford pear, and then it died, and now there's one canna down by the mailbox. It's just sad to me. I don't know if it's true or not. Look, want a little water in the landscape? But why don't we have to see the same water garden over and over? Don't we see in Jackson? Maybe it's because there's just one guy that does all the installations around there, but we get the rocks, you get the black rubber liner and the rocks around it, and then the waterfall rocks. Over and over, that's what you see. Maybe different shapes a little bit here and there, maybe a bigger waterfall, but that's what you see. But you go out to the northwest or you go up east and they have all kinds of different takes on water gardens. And why do we not use concrete anymore? I mean, you know, it's to me better looking than trying to cover up that black rubber liner. I love this one because you can walk across it too, and that just makes you feel so special. So a square, fine, just use some wild plants around it. It doesn't have to be an irregular shape at all. You can make this yourself out of concrete. This is simply a stiff mortar mix padded over a mound of sand till it sets up, and then you flip it over. You and all your strongest friends carry it where you want to in the garden. You can fill it up with water. It could be your dog's drinking bowl, or you could put a dwarf water lily in it. You don't have to paint it blue. You can if you want to. They do a lot of this up in the northwest and up east. These are just simply pillars, and then the water trickles off there, and so it has to fall quite a distance before it hits down here, which makes the sound carry better. And it gives you that strong structural element at the same time. Isn't that sad? I just think about all the money and the lack of imagination. We got the one of these, one of those, one of these, one of those, one of these, one of those, one of these, one of those. A monkey grass and a hot... They called it the reflecting pool because you looked at the reflection of the head. Do you really want to see that head twice? I am petty and small-minded, and I did take great joy in the fact that a bird had crapped on it. But that was about the only thing that I thought gave me any pleasure in the whole planting. I mean, really. So we need that money. We could do a lot more with that, couldn't we? For those who are afraid of snakes, my vet's wife is terrified of snakes, and she doesn't want a water garden because snakes will get in it. But she can walk all the way around this and examine it. Of course, I know, snakes can bite you right out on a dry path where there's no water and no ground cover around. Love this. It's always so mystical to me. This is at the Atlanta Botanic Garden, and their faces seem to move behind that flow, like they're trying to tell you what happened and how they got trapped back there. And I've joked often that I can't afford an artist like this, but I do wonder, I really do want to try this, buy some decent little concrete statues and break their heads off and put them behind a sheet of water and see how that would work. It probably will wear down over time, but it would be fun. I'm going to have to do it. Go on. Just a simple sheet of water over a pot. It's always an elegant look and a great way to go. Oh, I don't have my outdoor shower yet, but I will. I have an outdoor shower at my house down in Mississippi, and at my new house, it'll be out on the deck right outside the dog mud room. So if it's good weather, I can wash them outside. If it's cold weather, we'll go into the dog mud room. These are some friends of mine in Austin, and that is their bathroom right there. So they can shower inside if they like. But if they feel like it, they can step outside. And y'all, look at how simple it is. I mean, really. That is just, if you can't build that, I don't think you should be driving. It's nothing but, you know, 4x4s and corrugated tin, and plumbing is nothing but cutting and pasting the right parts together. And because this is Austin, they let the gray water just flow down and water their garden, so that was just a very simple thing to do. I think that's terrific. And for just a few oddball ideas, I love this idea for a vegetable garden. This, I should have backed up and photographed it better, but this is a square. There were four of these with crushed gravel between them. I'm going to do a little one better. I've got some leftover, the concrete block that split to look like rock, left over from building my house. So mine are going to be raised enough that I can sit on the edge and pick and weed. And I'm going to have four squares because you got to rotate your crops, right? Crushed gravel so I can go out there and get a tomato without getting my feet muddy. And I think I can keep that picked and weeded. Maybe. But that's going to be my vegetable garden. As soon as I get a little level piece of land, I got to find me some level property. Just a few other ideas. Fun with concrete. I love concrete. Of course, my dad did build the only cement plant in Mississippi, so maybe that's it. Concrete put me through school. But I love the idea of just having a little bit of garden ornament out there and something permanent. And you can make memories doing this, too. I went down after I learned to do some concrete leaf casting and brought all the materials, and my family got together and we all cast leaves. And we had the best time. We got pictures of everybody doing it. Everybody's got their cast leaves now on their porches, and it's a lot of fun. Just a few other odd thoughts I'm winding up is don't always go for the straight and symmetrical. I think we're in the habit of going in the nurseries and trying to find the most perfectly symmetrical tree with the roundest crown. And I think sometimes the ones that have the odd shape, that lean a bit, that add a little bit of sculpture, or that frame the view, are much more interesting. And also sometimes you can get them cheaper, which never hurts my feelings. Have a little fun with paint. Faye Beck carried this flower, which is the lilac chase tree called Shoals Creek, into the paint store and matched it and painted the pedestal and gazing ball to go with it. This is all, I love this. I think this is so much fun. So pick some particular. I do love purple. I was deprived of purple as a child, so I've been making up for it since. But something like that, just carry to the store and do something fun with paint in your landscape. This may be a little too far out, I admit. This was actually in East Tennessee, and I could not believe that these people had spray painted the pampas grass. But I've been daring people now, when your neighbor's out of town. If you'll do it, call me. I'll come get pictures, okay? You got to pick a neighbor with a good sense of humor, but I'm dying to see somebody actually do that. I guess I might have to do it to somebody in Jackson that I know can take it, but that would be so much fun. Paint the concrete leaves that are so much fun. This guy did such a beautiful job with his painting, and he said, you know, everybody else sets them on the ground and you can't see them. So he actually impaled his on rebar while they were still wet so he could stick them up in the air. And gosh, aren't they gorgeous? Ah, I just think those are stunning. All right, so to finish up, get as wild and crazy with your plants as you want to, as long as you add a little bit of structure. You'll have a disciplined look to your landscape, even on a small scale. It doesn't matter. You can do something very simple like this and then still just get away with whatever you're wanting to plant. If things die, not a big deal. Please remember to take care of our pollinators. I know a lot of people do gardening for butterflies, and of course I think that's great, but I also want people to remember our bees. And of course everybody talks about honeybees, and I get a little mad about it because honeybees aren't even native. Everybody thinks the whole world's going to end if we lose our honeybees. Well, you know what? We got along without them before we had them, and we can get along without them again if we take care of all our other great bees. So we need to take care of our solitary bees and our bumblebees and all the other pollinators we have out there. Yes, even some of those wasps and sweat bees and flies and beetles. And my gosh, the hummingbirds this year, I was just crazy with hummingbirds. But help take care of them, teach people to love them. It's always something that I think a lot of people think bees are something to be afraid of, and it's really not true. I love it when I can convince somebody to actually pet a bee. And this young lady was thrilled to do it, and the bee looks pretty happy with the whole thing, too. She was a little timid. I couldn't get her brother to do it, but she did it, so that was pretty cool. I love to close with this quote. because even though I'm talking mostly about design today and about how to have a good-looking design and still be a plant collector, y'all know that one of my major motivations is to have a great mix of plants for the critters, for the wild things. And this book that I really loved reading years ago was called The Wolf, the Woman, the Wilderness. And she talked about the fact that she liked to leave spiders in the house just because it was like having a skillful predator living just overhead. And I thought, that's the best excuse for poor housekeeping I've ever heard, and I'm stealing that one. But it is true, if we will kind of take in the idea of living with something wild, and of course dogs will keep you into that moment. You're living with descendants of the wolf, and that's part of the joy. They're kind of my zen. They keep me in the moment and in the now. So thanks for putting up with my ideas. Be sure to come and see us at the experiment station where I work in Jackson. What we do have are beautiful display gardens that are always open to the public. If you would like to have a tour, call ahead. I'll arrange a tour either with me or with Jason so that you can see what we have. And we really love to show it off. This is just a little bit of what we have as we pull up the front. And those are even more exciting now because, remember, those are the boring beds that we ripped out. So we're getting better and better every time. Every time you come, there's going to be something new and different, I promise. Our pumpkin display is stunning, and we hope you'll come see us. Thanks so much, and just one more, I think. Nope, that was it. Thank you all for coming again. Appreciate your time. Anybody have any questions?
The yucca that you had in the...
Bird bath? Yeah, I mean, I'm sure they water it. They don't have to water it every day by any means. I mean, I put that very same yucca in the urns in front of my vet's office because nobody ever waters. In fact, every time I call ahead and I'm bringing in a dog, as soon as I pull up in the parking lot, I see water running out of the pots because they know I'm coming. So I run out and water the yucca real quick. That's the only time they get watered. I know that's true. Huh? Yeah, they do need some, but they'll survive amazingly dry soils for quite some time. So, yes, they certainly need some. And they grow faster and look better when you water them. As long as that drainage is good. Yes, ma'am.
Is the experiment station open on the weekend?
It always is open, any daylight hour.
Are the plants identical?
Mostly, we try to keep everything labeled. Sometimes labels disappear. We relabel once a year. So if it's not, I apologize, but you know we do refresh them right before our field day every summer. But I just noticed the other day there was a euchre I was admiring out in the shade garden and the label was gone. I don't know if people want to remember the name and take them with them or something, but they seem to go away. Yeah, and there's a, on your handout, our webpage, west.tennessee.edu, you'll find a map. You'll find lots of good stuff on there. Actually, you'll go there and then go to UT Gardens, and you'll see our events page. You can link to our plants of the month. We write up a plant of the month, all kinds of information. Our no spray rose trials, lots of information from that page. We're on Facebook now too, UT Gardens Jackson, and I usually have my column linked to our web page. I write a column that comes out every Friday. So may not get linked to the Facebook page until Monday, but usually by Monday my column's linked to that Facebook page as well. Yes?
On those, the concrete thing you did over the sand and those leaves, that's not the tufa mix. What is that mix?
You actually want to use a finer mortar mix because you want the detail. So you can either use a what's just called mortar mix, which is mostly sand like you would use between bricks, or there's one that's got an acrylic patch is what it's called. An acrylic patch is a little stronger, and it'll give you even more detail.
So it's a bag of, like,
uh-huh.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, acrylic patch.
And the leaf, is that too? It's not too heavy?
Oh, that's pretty heavy. That one was pretty heavy.
But the rebar stays in it?
Yes. Okay. Yes. You'll need to play with that a little bit. And if you're going to do a leaf that's going to be upright like that, I might also put some of that reinforcement mesh.
Okay.
Yes. Yes. Anybody else? Thanks. I'm sorry y'all were so far over there. I kept trying to go. Good. All right. Thank you very much. Appreciate y'all.